Microlecture 37, Decolonization in Africa and Asia. By the mid-1960s, most of Africa gained its independence from the European powers. Only Portugal's colonies and South Africa remain under white minority rule, which effectively end in 1975 after long armed conflict. In Africa, many independentist leaders saw socialism as the best way to sever colonial ties and erase exploitation within their new borders. Most of these African countries inherited the Europeans' obsolete colonial bureaucracies, economic systems, and education systems. These institutions were outdated and made the decolonization efforts more difficult. Additionally, the colonial powers did not want to lose their colonies, and in the context of the Cold War, there was a robust ideological battle for the continent. In Africa, the decolonization process was complicated for many reasons. Western education did not consolidate there until the 1920s, and as a consequence, national movements took longer to establish. Another reason that illustrates the difficulties of decolonization in Africa was the diversity of ethnic groups and how they were organized within colonial borders, since different people were forced to form, quote, nations, unquote, without having many things in common, creating distinct political, cultural nationalism was complicated. The first signs of African nationalism came from thinkers and intellectuals from the United States and the Caribbean. W.E.B. Du Bois, 1868-1963, for example, found the National Association for the Advance of Colored People, NAACP, and organized the Pan-African Congress in Paris in 1919 and Brussels in 1921. Pan-Africanists saw black solidarity and a self-governing union of all African peoples. It was a dream difficult to achieve, but it had many supporters around the world. In the Caribbean, the Jamaican-born intellectual Marcus Garvey, 1887-1940, organized young Africans and promoted the idea of building Africa for Africans. In the 1920s and the 1930s, anti-colonial and nationalist ideas became popular amongst Africans and people of African descent in French and British colonies. In Europe, African intellectuals formulated and articulated the concept of blackness, which implied pride, self-confidence, and creativity. Most of this group of people's political grievances include better access to jobs, self-government, and policies to fight against racism and discrimination. Their intellectuals claimed their right to speak for ordinary Africans and denounced local African elites for subordinating themselves to white colonial leaders. The economic conditions of the Great Depression also influenced the rise of African nationalism. Many people mobilized against colonialists and foreign companies due to the harsh working conditions they experienced. Mass organizations and protests were effective in awakening people's consciousness. In the 1940s, especially after World War II, Africa experienced significant changes. Many African soldiers participated in the war, which helped them understand that the Europeans were vulnerable and not almighty. Traveling around the world, these soldiers also learned about nationalist movement in Asia, and what they saw there inspired them to fight for their freedom. In economic terms, African mines, plantations, and resources were exploited to meet wartime demands, which accelerated hardships and discontent in the continent. African people began to believe that it was possible to have the autodetermination they were looking for. The new African leadership that emerged from these conditions was impatient, insistent, and calls for a modern African nationalism were remarkably successful. Taking advantage of their European or American education, this leadership created an authentic African way of thinking that helped them in their independence struggles. The post-war African nationalism was very pragmatic in accepting colonial boundaries to avoid border disputes and, in that way, achieve independence quicker. traditional African leaders since they were losing power over the population and, in some cases, become obstacles in the way of the new generation of reformers. However, the new leaders channeled the African people's aspirations correctly and were able to gain support for their mass political organizations. The first sub-Saharan country to gain independence from the Europeans was Ghana, which before World War II was known as the Gold Coast. Led by a charismatic Western-educated leader named Kwame Nkrumah, the country achieved self-governance after effectively mobilizing a diverse group of people that included veterans, women, students, union members, and farmers. In 1957, Nkrumah gained international recognition by becoming Ghana's first prime minister. After Ghana, many other African territories started their struggle for independence, fighting colonialists and white settlers who fought to preserve their privileged position. In French-speaking Africa, the situation was different, but the events in the North African colony of Algeria in the 1950s and 1960s helped convince the world that anti-colonialism was an unstoppable force. At first, France attempted to retain Algeria because it had a significant white European, mostly Catholic population occupying the country. In 1954, Algeria's anti-colonial movement, the National Liberation Front, started a war for independence against France. In that war, more than 500,000 Algerians were killed and millions of people were displaced. The war ended in 1962, when the Algerians were able to form an independent nation. Belgium and Portugal's colonies also sought independence, and countries such as Angola, Mozambique, and the Congo were able to achieve self-determination by the end of the 1950s. In some cases, independence triggered conflicts and wars. World War II also accelerated the independence of the Indian subcontinent. The struggle for self-determination in India started in the 1920s when Mahatma Gandhi launched a national campaign of non-violent resistance to the British rule. Among other things, Gandhi convinced his countrymen to boycott British goods, not pay taxes, not work for the empire, or receive its honors. The Indian people well received the call for non-violent resistance. The nationalist movement agglomerated the well-educated elites and the illiterate masses who collectively began to practice militant non-violent resistance. The campaign particularly appealed to the Hindus, who were not from the warrior class. Until then, the British believed ordinary Hindus were cowards, but Gandhi taught them that they could be strong, courageous, and morally superior. The colonizer did not know how to respond to a non-violent challenge. Gandhi used to say, quote, "Believe me that a man devoid of courage and manhood can never be a passive resistor," end quote. For his resistance against the British regime, Gandhi was sent to prison for 2 years in 1922. After his release, he organized a commune, founded a national newspaper, and worked towards reforming Indian society in favor of the poor. More importantly, Gandhi advocated for moral improvement, national identity, and self-respect. In 1935, the British negotiated with Gandhi after a nationwide protest against salt taxes. As a result, a new constitution called the Government of India Act was signed. In 1942, Gandhi called on the British to, quote, "quit India," end quote, and threatened another civil disobedience campaign. He was arrested again and sent to prison for most of World War II. In India, there were two majoritarian populations at the time, the Hindu and the Muslims. When the war ended, the British agreed to Indian independence, but conflicts between the Hindu and the Muslims emerged. The conflict led to the partition of the subcontinent in two different nations, India and Pakistan. In 1948, Gandhi, who since 1945 tried to stop violence between the two communities, was assassinated by a Hindu gunman who resented Gandhi's peaceful attitude towards the Muslims. Palestine is another important place to understand the effects of decolonization after World War II. Before the Second World War, Arab nationalists were the majority in the country. In the aftermath of the Second World War, Jews began to move there, something that the Palestinians and the new Arab states emerging from British and French domination strenuously opposed. In 1947, the British government announced its intention to withdraw from Palestine. In 1948, the recently created United Nations was left with the difficult task of finding a Jewish homeland. The international organization passed a plan for Palestine's partition in two separate states, one Arab and one Jewish. This partition was resisted by the Arabs who lived in the territory and was accepted by the Jews. The partition was the start of a political, social, and cultural conflict that continues today. The decolonization of Africa and Asia after World War II is a major historical event that continues to have importance today from a local and a global perspective. This is all I have for you today. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.